YouTubers, Hankster here, and welcome to another Star Wars review. It's not exactly a review, but it's sort of my opinion so far type thing, because I haven't really watched a complete season yet of this series, but obviously I got to have my say-so about it, because it definitely is canon. Of course, it's Star Wars Rebels, the latest television series based on the Star Wars saga, made by the same makers of Star Wars The Clone Wars, the second animated series, by the way. As far as I'm concerned, my opinion is that this is basically was the result of the original plan started by George Lucas, that they were going to do a live-action Star Wars television series that was going to take place pre-episode 4. George Lucas made that announcement back around late 2005, I believe. Around the same time he announced about Clone Wars, the CGI Clone Wars, he did announce that they were going to do a live-action Star Wars series. And since there's going to be, actual actors and going to be new characters and stuff like that interacting with, like Vader and all that. But I guess they kind of weren't able to do that, especially, of course, with the takeover of Disney and everything. They decided to just make that a CGI series as well, and which, it'd be kind of cool if they did this for live action. But of course, now they're kind of focusing on the doing more movies, not just the episodic movies, but also these little side story movies that are coming out. So I guess it's kind of it's more intelligent to just do more CGI oriented television than trying to get a live action series going. Well, they might do it in the future. I don't know, another project in the future. But pretty much this is, I'm not totally familiar with all the most of the newer characters. I know Ezra's the main character. He's the young boy, Force-sensitive young man who's was found by a group of rebels. And, of course, one of them is a former Jedi who's teaching him the ways of the Force. One of the survivors of Order 66. And Venus is, of course, closer to Episode 4 than Episode 3. Of course, Jedi are still being hunted down, and by these being known as the Inquisitors, who are, of course, Force-sensitive themselves, and they have these unusual lightsabers that kind of spin around with a little round thing in the middle. And my impression, when I saw the first Inquisitor, they got an action figure of a regular action figure of him out, too. He looks kind of like, in my opinion, the son. If you remember the multi-part episode where Anakin and Obi-Wan and Ahsoka are trapped in that sort of like a pocket universe or something like that, and they meet up with the father, the son, and the daughter, and the son is the dark side, and the daughter is the light side of the Force. And the first Inquisitor looks just like him. Of course, he also looks like he's from Utapau, so I don't know. Yeah, he's got that Utapau look about him. If you remember the race of beings from Utapau, where Obi-Wan gets that dragon looking thing, and he rides in, to take on General Grievous for the last time. That kind of thing. So that's, not too bad there. Of course, they got, for the new season, they got two new ones to replace him, because he was defeated. Of course, there's other one. There's this big giant guy. I think he was based on a prototype that George Lucas had for Chewbacca. I think when he was doing the original for Episode 4, all those years back, he was sort of like the earlier version of Chewbacca, but they kind of turned him into his own race, pretty much. And then you got a Twi'lek pilot. You got a female Mandalorian, which is pretty cool. I see more female Mandalorians. I got my own original character who's a female Mandalorian, Of course, she's the daughter of Boba Fett, but this is one of my role-playing characters. And of course, then, as I said, there's the former Jedi, and of course, there's a cranky astromech droid as well, Clunker or Clanker or something like that. Let's look at some interesting concepts going into the series. I mean, obviously, they got James Earl Jones to reprise his role as the voice of Darth Vader, which is pretty cool. It's not all the time, but, you know, Vader's not shown all the time, but that's cool. Billy Dee Williams made a guest appearance as Lando Calrissian, which is also pretty cool. I mean, it's just as cool as he was when he was playing himself on an episode of Modern Family. And, of course, Ahsoka Tano returns, kind of filling in that. Everybody was wondering what happened to her after she left the Order, Jedi Order, in Clone Wars. Now we know she's still alive and well, and, of course, she's probably in her 30s by now. Still looking pretty young. But, of course, now the obvious question is she going to face Darth Vader, especially that if you caught that episode where, with this one scene where she's trying to figure out who this mysterious pilot is, she finds out it's Vader, and, of course, when she delves into his mind, she realizes it's Anakin, and of course, Vader finds out it's her, so what's going to happen when they finally do meet and have to fight each other for first time they've seen each other since before Order 66, obviously. So that's going to be an obvious thing. Of course, she's not a frequent character. I mean, she's on there once in a while, but and of course you have the clones from Clone Wars that they're still alive. You got to remember the clones were their lifespan was augmented, so they age faster than regular humans. They so that's why they look pretty. They look older than they should if they were normally aging. But they age 5 years faster than everybody else. So, but it's a miracle that these guys are still alive, being they'd be over have the appearance of being over 100 years old or so, being that this is supposed to be like 20 almost 20 years after the Clone Wars is over with, and all. These guys are fighting like they're a bunch of, you know, maybe like guys that are in their late 50s or something. But, of course, I don't know what the average lifespan of a Mandalorian is. So, you know, this is Star Wars. This is not like Earth where, you know, they'd be rolling around in wheelchairs and stuff. These are alien, you know, technically beings with maybe awfully longer lifespans than average humans. Earth humans, so we'll have to find out about that as well. But it's a promising series. It looks pretty good. I'm glad that they kind of tie it in. It's like tie in both the original Star Wars, the original trilogy with the prequel trilogy, obviously. So that, you know, obviously they tie in a lot of loose ends and all. Obviously, the question is, Hopi, what's going to happen to Ahsoka? You know, obviously, because you don't see her in the original trilogy either. Sooner or later, kind of putting her into a movie, if anything. Let's bring her into the new trilogy, for crying out loud. but this is just my little, not really a review, but my opinion or my few words to say about Star Wars Rebels. You can catch it on Disney XD with new episodes. It's currently in its second season. Maybe try to catch more episodes, that you know, older episodes when they come on and all. But that's just what I wanted to say about the series. And, of course, our next Star Wars review, of course, will be on Episode 4, The New Hope, the very first Star Wars movie ever to be released in theaters. And, of course, being that I'm in that right generation that was there when it happened, I'll give you my opinion as best I can about how I was when the Star Wars phenomena first hit the world. in the late 70s and all. But stay tuned for that. And stay tuned here for more reviews and whatnot here on the Multiverse. See you.